Welcome to Nasdaq Trade Talks. I'm Jill Malandrino, Global Markets Reporter at Nasdaq. Joining me to kick off day five in our final day of coverage for the Singapore FinTech Festival is Chad Cascarilla. He's the co-founder and CEO of Paxos to discuss the move in Bitcoin and if it's different than 2017. Chad, it's great to see you again, of course, virtually. Welcome back to Trade Talks.
Oh, it's great to be here. Thanks for having me on. Good to see you too.
And it's so interesting, Chad, when we talk about valuations in the stock market, it's always compared to 1999, but with Bitcoin, 2017 seems to be that benchmark. So what's currently driving the interest in crypto markets and Bitcoin's price surging? Is it any different than 2017?
I think it's fundamentally different, which is what's probably really exciting for the space. And I think it's really important to realize that unlike 2017, when we were still in the early adopter phase of this industry, we're now going from early adopter to, I believe, mainstream. And so when you think early adopter, I really mean tens of millions of people that were involved in the ecosystem. But going to mainstream is about billions of people. And I feel very confident in saying that because if I look at our pipeline at Paxos, maybe it was single digit millions of people a year ago, and now it's billions of people. And so that's just an unbelievable phase shift. And just as important, it's not just the number of people in our pipeline or that's going on. You can see who now owns it. You know, Mass Mutual came out today. There's institutional owners. Before, this was still really very nascent. You were just getting it listed on the CME. You were just getting it future.
Chad, because when you talk about the acceleration of trends, you can make the same argument for a number of technology equities that have seen their trends accelerate 3 to 5 years down the line. Zoom, for example, right? And how we communicate in the cloud experience and so forth. You know, being a hodler since 2018, it's been incredible to watch how Bitcoin works and how it trades. And one of the things I was most excited about this year was PayPal's announcement that it's going to offer that crypto experience, and Paxos is powering that. So tell us more about that.
Yeah, we're really proud of this. We built Paxos specifically for the mainstream adoption phase of this industry. And the reason we built the firm for this was because we believed it would happen. And so we've set up the company by building a very comp that involves Bitcoin, involves crypto. People are excited by it. 27% of millennials own some type of crypto. And that is a demographic that people really want to be able to reach out to and interact with.
Well, I'm older than a millennial and I'm involved. So I think it's really fascinating.
Well, we're some of the 6% non-millennials that own crypto. So there you have it.
There you go. Well, look, think about direct deposit. That was something that, you know, a lot of people never wanted to do. They wanted their physical check in their cash paper. Totally. And that's gone the way of the dodo. So I'm glad you brought up regulation, because when you think about cryptocurrency and the technology it's built on, the whole point is decentralization, right? But regulation can almost be a good thing. So my question to you is, what needs to change from a regulatory perspective to further increase mainstream adoption of crypto?
I mean, this is a key thing. Regulation is not always bad. It depends on how you apply it, just like any other tool. And so regulation can create trustworthiness, which can lead to adoption. And ultimately, if this is going to be about mass adoption, billions of people, you're not going to do that without any regulation, especially in an industry like financial services. And so that's what predicated our business model of being a regulated platform. And I think, you know, you don't want to have regulation that's so onerous that small companies can't get involved. I think that would be really terrible, because we need to have innovation. We need to continue to push what's going on. I think certain things can be done in the US, for instance, to improve the regulatory landscape. The first is allowing some type of passporting between states. Getting money transmission licenses between every single state is really cumbersome. In the case of Paxos, we're a trust company. So we're a banking institution. And we're a banking institution in the state of New York, the first one that was approved for this in May of 2015. But at the same time, we don't have explicit reciprocity in every single state. Now, there was some news that came out that we've now applied for a trust bank through the national bank regulator, the OCC. And partly that was premised because we can't get preemption and passporting as a state bank, as a state trust company. And so simplifying that process could make a huge difference. It shouldn't be so impossible for anybody to be able to operate in financial services. And so I think that's an important point, creating some type of sandbox where, you know, if you have $1 million or $2 million of business, that's a lot different from having hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars of business or tens of millions of customers. When is the right time to apply which rules instead of one size fits all, which is how it is now? So there's a way to get smarter about this and at the same time creating safety and soundness and trustworthiness.
That's a great point that you bring up. It is not a one-size-fits-all model. So Chad, my final question to you is, what's going to get institutional financial firms to make the jump into crypto? We've seen Square, we've seen PayPal, we've seen a number of other newer fintech companies again. But when we talk about our big banks or traditional legacy banks, they're tied into the central banking system and so forth. What's it going to take to get them over to the crypto side?
Well, I think what happens inevitably is you just need the first one, because when that happens, that person who blazes the trail really opens up a whole number of opportunities. And so we saw that in some sense with the fintech firms. So you had some of the early stage fintech firms like SoFi and Revolut and Robinhood get in, and then Square, and then PayPal. And now it's become really quite common now for fintech firms of all sizes. And I think you're going to see that with a couple of the small banks get involved, mid-sized banks. We had some news about Standard Chartered wanting to offer this. I can tell you, when we look at our pipeline, all of the large banks are considering this and taking it really serious. And I think some things will happen in the first quarter of next year. And when that first one happens, I think it's going to come very, very quickly after that.